Thank you. Well, hey, Reg Church, we're so glad you guys could join us here today. Why don't you stand, and we're going to sing and worship together.
I will build my life upon your love, and is a firm foundation. I will put song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, we live for you, Jesus, the name above every other name, Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. And holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
Oh,
Christ alone, my hope is found. He's my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. Every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. His body lay, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curses precious blood of Christ. And I find my strength, I find my hope, I find my help in Christ alone. When fear assails, when darkness falls, I find my peace in Christ alone. Is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for today. Lord, we thank you so much for this year. Even though it was difficult at times, even though there's pain and confusion, even there seems like there's a lot of chaos and uncertainty, Lord, we know that you are still in control. You are still on the throne. And so we lean into that. Lord, we lean into you. And we give this next year, this next season of our lives to you. Lord, be with us through the rest of this service. Lord, will you speak to the depths of our hearts and allow us to receive what it is you have. We love you, we praise you. And it's in your amazing name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning and welcome to Ridge Church. It is so good to have you with us, and I just want to wish you from myself and our whole staff team, Merry Christmas. Whatever it has looked like this year, we just hope that you've had a chance to celebrate and to be joyful. And this Christmas, we know, has looked different, like really, really different. Not like I went to one family's house instead of the other, but like really, really different. And so whatever your Christmas has looked like, however it has felt, we just want to welcome you here this morning. As you're watching, whatever you might be feeling this morning, we just want to invite you that it's okay to bring it here, to bring it before Jesus right now. And as we hop into a bit of a shorter service, a bit of a dialed back service, as we take time to rest and reflect, as we finish off what has been such a tough year and head into a new year, which in the end is really just another set of days and another calendar that is kind of all over the map, but the reality is it feels like a new start. And so as we rest, as we come into that, we just want to welcome you here. And I hope that whatever your Christmas has looked like, I hope it's felt joyful. I hope it's been filled with real, deep, soul-level joy. And I know it's been different, and I know there's been lots of loss this Christmas, but my hope and my prayer, and I think I speak on behalf of our whole staff and our pastoral team, is that we hope for you that you've experienced the shalom, the peace of God on your lives over these last couple days, whether that's through sleeping in or reading a good book or watching a classic Christmas movie with friends or just remembering and rejoicing in the reality that Jesus came. We are so excited to just be here together for short service, a short time to connect. As we continue on in this series, a bit of an extension of what Jonathan spoke on this Christmas Eve as we celebrated together, what we're looking at is what the gift of 2020 is. And you might think that's absolutely crazy to say, but if you would turn in your Bibles to James chapter 1, it's near the very end of your Bible. If you're new to the Bible, if you're not familiar with the Bible, it's right near the end. Just find it there, James chapter 1, or you can read it behind me on the screen. And wherever you're at this morning, we just want to invite you to read these words with us. James 1, starting in verse 2. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. And that's a verse we want to look at today because I think it's a really important command, but also promise that we get to cling to. Because this Christmas has not been normal. It has been weird. And if you think about what our culture or what our world, or even if we're honest, our own hearts would say joy is all about, what experiencing joy at Christmas feels like, it seems like that would be impossible, right? Like, I can't experience the things that if you asked me a year ago or even a few months ago in summer, What would a joyful Christmas look like? I probably would have explained, you know, being with my family, having dinner together, getting to sit down and see people I haven't gotten to see in nearly a year. I would have talked about all these special experiences and traditions and all those kind of things that would make it joyful. And I don't know what your December has looked like, but for Jaleesa, my wife, and I, a lot of our December, at least the earlier parts, was having conversations about what is it we do? Do we see family? Do we not see family? The rules are this. They seem kind of vague here. What is it we're supposed to do? And we were having such a hard time making a decision, like so much of 2020. And I remember looking at Jaleesa as we were talking about it, and it felt like every time we had a conversation about it, we just couldn't land on something that felt right. And I remember sitting with her, and she looked at me and she said this really profound thing that's really stuck with me. She looked at me and she said, Dan, no decision feels peaceful. Like, there's no decision that feels, this is good, this is right, this is exactly what we're supposed to do. Because in a year like this, because in a year like 2020 has felt anything but peaceful. All the decisions that have had to be made, all the risks that we've had to process through whenever we think about seeing someone or connecting with someone, all the things we've had to kind of lose and take away from, whether that's events or grads or anything, all those things have not felt peaceful. 2020 has not been a year that feels filled with the peace and joy of the world, right? Even as we sing those songs, even as we try to grasp and cling to this reality of who Jesus is, it doesn't always feel like that. And maybe December 27th, you're sitting there and Christmas came and Christmas went and you thought maybe by Christmas things will be back to normal and I'll be able to be okay, and it just doesn't feel that way yet. We want you to know you're not alone in that. If you are sitting there this morning on December 27th and you feel a little bit discouraged and a little bit disappointed, we just want you to know you're not alone. That's a normal human reaction to all that is going on in the world, of the heartbreak and the loss that this season has held. We hope you've experienced joy, and we believe that you can experience joy, as James writes in this passage that we're going to look at today. But at the end of the day, we want you to know that you are not alone in what you are experiencing in a year that feels like loss after loss and challenge after challenge. That's why I think this passage is so powerful. Is because James is writing to a group of people. If you go back to the very first verse of James, when he introduces himself, James is most likely Jesus' younger brother, who's writing to a group of people, to a group of Christians, that he actually calls the dispersed church. The people of God who had been through persecution and through struggle and through political issues and through all sorts of stuff in the Roman Empire that they existed in had been dispersed. This is based on a passage in Acts that talks about the persecution of the church and how the church had been kind of all over the map except for the apostles who stayed where they were. And this crazy thing happens where you know, they are all over the place. But James says, you can have joy in the midst of this trial. He says that to a people group who, even more so than us, were feeling and engaging with a couple of different things. One, they probably had deep discouragement about their place as Christians in the world. Christianity at this point was a brand new faith. The idea of saying we follow Jesus, we believe this guy Jesus died and rose again, was craziness. People would look at them like, what are you talking about? How could you believe something so crazy? They, as a scattered church, as a persecuted church, they were facing a reality that they couldn't gather to worship. They couldn't come together in an auditorium like this or even the temple without fear of persecution. They were not able to gather together for a worship service. The world felt overwhelmingly complicated to navigate. There was so many things going on. There was political unrest, constant power shifts and political games in the Roman Empire. That was just the nature of how an empire like that worked. And ultimately, and maybe you can relate to this, a question of why would God allow these things to happen? Why is God letting all this happen? How could God allow all this struggle, all this pain, all this suffering? Even as we sing songs like A Joy to the World, which is such a beautiful declaration that God is doing something good in everything that is going on in our world, how could God let this stuff happen? We can't meet, we can't be together, we can't do what we want to. People think we're crazy for believing what we believe. And if that sounds a little bit familiar to you, well, it's not entirely unlike 2020, but on a totally different scale. Because you and I in Canada in 2020, as followers of Jesus, we are in the middle of something very similar. And so these words ring true. But much like a mistimed Bible verse when you're struggling, right? We all know that feeling of someone who's really well-meaning but just kind of throws out a Bible verse at us when we're in the middle of a hard season. We don't need to hear it. It just feels like more of like an attack with the Bible. And what we really need is someone's presence and somebody throws a Bible verse at us like, consider it joy. We don't need that. And so maybe a verse like this right now, if you're feeling disappointed or lonely, can just feel like it rings hollow. Can feel like it's more discouraging than it is encouraging. It rings hollow, but I want you to know just again that you are not alone in that, and that God is not unaware of what you are going through. I want you to know you're not alone in that because I felt that this year. Our staff team or my family who's closest to me, my closest friends, could tell you that over the last number of weeks, I felt extremely discouraged. The idea of a joyful, beautiful, fun, happy Christmas has not been what is there for me. I've been distraught about the fact that I can't go see my family. I felt really disconnected from trying to get to know and be in community in a city that my wife and I only moved to about a year ago. I felt really discouraged about what are we going to do. And so I look back at 2020 and I look at, there's this excitement, right? In January and February, there was all this excitement about what's 2020 going to hold. And we talked about things like 2020 vision and all these things were so exciting. But then spring comes and it's just crushing. And then summer comes and it's still weird, but it's starting to get better. It's starting to feel a little more normal. And then I remember in November that when Bonnie Henry announced these new restrictions and we moved into the second wave and the second lockdown and these numbers went up, I just felt like the wind got knocked out of me. You know what I'm saying? Where it just feels like the information and the reality of all that's going on just like hits you in the gut and feels like too much to take. And there's been lots of times and days and even weeks in the last couple of months where I've just felt the weight of all that's going on in the world. The wind knocked out of my friendships and my ability to connect with people, especially my family. What feels like Christmas is canceled. And maybe you're sitting here post-Christmas and maybe you've had a really good chance to connect with people, but maybe you haven't because it's different and it's been such a hard year. But as I look at 2020 as a whole, it can feel like an emotional roller coaster. And if you've been on a roller coaster is really, really fun until it's not. And when you hit that point, you just want to get off. I just want it to be over. I just want it to be done. And you look at what everyone's feeling right now, and it's just this, just get done with 2020. All this pain, all this suffering, we just want to be done with it. We just want to be into 2021 because it feels like a fresh start. And I think in some sense it will be, but still we live in the reality of COVID-19. We live in the reality of political unrest. We live in the reality of a culture that maybe rejects our faith or causes us to doubt or struggle or walk through all that we need to walk through. And some people, myself included, are a little more driven by emotion. And so we feel really, really overwhelmed by that. But others, and my wife Jaleesa would be included in this, are less driven by emotion and more driven by logic, by an ability to look at things and say, okay, what factors need to be considered here in just the reality of the way that things are? It's an incredible gift. I'm so thankful for the people in my life who can do this, like my wife, like a mentor of mine. But logic is a really important thing to have because it allows us to step back and gain perspective. And that's what James invites us into. Listen again to verse 2. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you make trials of various kinds. Now notice that first word, count. Depending on what translation you're using, you might read the word consider there. But I think count is such a great word because it asks us to think mathematically or logically about our trials. It asks us to think, okay, how does this stack up? How do all the factors at play, everything that's happened in 2020, how does it all stack up and play into how I look back on this year? Is it all emotion? Is it all the pain? Is it all the loss? Or is there something that can be redeemed and something good that can be brought out of it? James would say, absolutely there can and there should be. Add up everything and see if it comes out as a positive or negative. Everything. But you might be sitting there thinking right now, how could anyone count 2020 as a joy? How could anyone count a year like this as a joy? This year just sucks. It's all loss. It's all pain, it's all struggle, it's all suffering, it's all bad. I just want it to be over. I just want to forget about it. I just want to move past it. But how anyone could count 2020 as joy is not something that James leaves us without an answer for. See, one of the things I love about this is that this verse, you hear quoted all the time, count it joy when you face trials of many kinds. But the most important part of that command is the reason why we can cling to that command, why we can actually fulfill it. And James says that. Verse 3, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, or in other translations, endurance. and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may become perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. The second part of this message that James gives, which doesn't always make it onto the Christian coffee mug, which doesn't always make it onto the thing we share on Facebook, the second part of this is the why behind the what. It's the reason why you and me, no matter what our year has held, no matter what we've lost, no matter what struggle there has been, no matter the tears that have been shed or the anger that you feel and the tension that's in your chest when you think about this year, you can look and you can count it as joy. That you can count that this year has not all been lost. Why behind the what is that God is doing something in you. God is forming something in you this year. As we close out 2020, here's what I want you to know. God is shaping you. He is forming something in your life that matters, not just for this year, not just to get through it, but for the rest of your life. As you prepare and get ready for an eternity spent with Jesus, he is forming something in you that matters right now. And we look at that verse. What is it? It's something that's going to require faith. It's something that's going to require steadfastness or endurance, but it's something that's going to bring about completion. It's going to move us closer to where Jesus has been moving us all along in this process that theologically we call sanctification. But really what that means is just growing towards Christ-likeness. It's becoming who we already are because of what Jesus has done for us on the cross. Somehow, paradoxically, our faith as followers of Jesus in 2020 allows us to look and not only see what has been lost, but what is being formed, what is being shaped in our lives. The New Testament uses language, and Jesus himself used language regularly in his teaching of dying to oneself as a form of how we imitate what Jesus has done for us, how we move by day, by day, by day, by God's grace and the Holy Spirit's work in our lives towards Christ-likeness, or if you prefer the term, holiness. That's what we talk about when we talk about holiness. It's not being perfect. It's not willpower to say, I'm just going to handle it and grit my teeth and I'm going to be grumpy all the time, but at least I don't sin very much. If you're grumpy all the time, that's not how Jesus invites you to live life. That's not the abundance that Jesus is inviting you into. And I think a lot of us this year, we're just grumpy. But we're invited to experience joy in our trials, not just grumpiness in them. And the New Testament uses this language of dying to oneself. Why? Because in the image of the gospel, at the end of the day, what we celebrate at Christmas is that Christ came, not just that he came, but that he came to die and rise again, to redeem us, to save us, to restore us in right relationship to God. What we celebrate at Christmas, the image of that gospel message that maybe you heard for the very first time on the 24th as you celebrated Christmas with us and Jonathan shared about what it looks like for sacrifice, the greatest, most ultimate gift of all time is Jesus' life given for us. The image of that gospel is that we cannot have resurrection without crucifixion. We cannot get there without pain and suffering. The image of Christ, the gospel of Jesus, is that after the sacrifice and the pain and the suffering and the sweating blood in the Garden of Gethsemane comes more pain on the cross, but ultimately leads to resurrection life. We cannot get there. There is no resurrection Sunday without crucifixion Friday. There is no life and ministry of Jesus without the birth of Jesus in a terrible, brutal situation. You know what happens right after Christmas? It doesn't get easy. They have to flee as refugees to Egypt. There is something to be had on the other end of suffering. That is part of the message of the gospel that we celebrate at Christmas. We celebrate the audacity of a God who would lay aside all his glory, all his majesty, every right that God of the universe, the creator of all things, has to say, it's all for me. It's all made by me. All the glory is mine. He set it all aside. Here's what Philippians 2, verse 7 and 8 says when Paul describes Jesus himself. Jesus emptied himself by taking the form of what? A servant. And in the words of Isaiah 53, in a very famous passage, a suffering servant. He was born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, that's what we celebrate at Christmas, Jesus humbled himself. How? by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. God himself leans into suffering because he sees that it produces something, that it takes us somewhere, that suffering in and of itself is not the end of the story, that the pain and the sadness and the tears, that's not the end of the story. The promise of the gospel, the last pages of the Bible celebrate that God will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Every tear shed in 2020 will be wiped away in Christ, and that is a promise we can celebrate. The pain you felt over this Christmas of not being able to see family, the pain you felt in your loneliness this year of not being able to connect with people, the loss and the struggle of lost employment and lost life in a pandemic, all those tears will be wiped away. That is our ultimate reality, but it's on the other side of suffering. And what's beautiful about this verse that we're looking at in James today is that it shows us that right in the middle of suffering, not just on the other end of it, God is doing something. Our ability to endure suffering is actually largely determined by our ability to see purpose within it. I think a lot of the time we look at suffering and we say, there's something better on the other side of this. Someday it'll be better. Someday I'll learn a better lesson or whatever it may be. After suffering, then it'll be okay. But what this verse is saying is not just that there's something better on the other end of suffering, but that in the middle of it, right in the middle of suffering, right in the middle of pain, right in the middle of a year like 2020, there is something beautiful to be had, and it's what God is forming in us. We live in a culture that said there is no meaning in suffering. We don't have a concept for it. If I'm suffering, if I'm struggling, what do I need to do? Get rid of it. Watch some more Netflix. Do anything to get rid of that feeling that's gnawing at me, that I don't have purpose, that I'm not gonna be okay. Whatever suffering I'm facing, I just push it to the side. Watch another episode of The Office. Scroll Instagram for a little longer. Try to figure out how to make Christmas special. And none of those things are bad per se, but they don't give us purpose. They don't. There's a reason you can watch 8 hours of Netflix and just feel more tired. It's because there's no purpose in it. There's no purpose while you're suffering to just distract yourself. But what God invites us to is to strip back everything in a year of suffering like this and to see the ultimate truth of the gospel. And what is it? That Jesus is enough. For you and for me and for each and every one of us is that in the middle of our suffering, not just on the other side of it, Jesus is enough. And that is a beautiful promise that we get to cling to. 2020, it'll make us or it'll break us. I actually believe that. This year has been, for many of us, the hardest, most challenging, most confusing, most frustrating, most overwhelming year of our entire lives. It's been hard in a very real way. But over the coming weeks and months and years and decades, long after a vaccine brings us back to some form of normal, long after this auditorium that I'm standing in today is filled with people once again worshiping Jesus together, which is beautiful, and I can't wait for it. I long for it. I pray for it. I'm so excited for that day when we get to do this again. But long after COVID-19 is a story we tell, it'll still be affecting us. In some way, shape, or form, it will have formed us and shaped us. The reality that you need to know today is, as you close out your year, as you close out your 2020, as maybe you're wrapping up these last couple of days and you're just like, I just want it behind me. I just want to go from 2019 to 2021 because this year is the worst. I understand, but here's what I need you to know today. The suffering of a year like 2020, it will shape you. Whether you like it or not, suffering will shape you. But the invitation of James in this passage and God throughout the Bible is that you get to choose how it shapes you. Will you spend the next decade bitter and angry at a year of loss and suffering? Or might you be able to look and say, what has God formed in me this year? What kind of endurance, what kind of steadfastness, what kind of faith has God been trying to form in me this year? And if I'm really honest, I feel like I've missed out on what God wants for me this year because I've spent so much time feeling sorry for myself, feeling sorry for the losses and the hurts and all those things. And I don't ever want to take away from the pain of all that. It's very real. It's very there. But here's the deal. God's been trying to do something in me. God's been trying to do something in me, and I'm so busy feeling sorry for myself that I've missed it. And I don't want to miss it. As we look forward to 2021, I want to have the equipment to deal with suffering well. I want to have the equipment to look at the world, to look at suffering, to look at reality, to not just like paint over it and be like, oh, everything's okay and God's got us and all those things and just be flippant and say these things that really don't make sense and not consider. No, I want to look at reality. I want to look at suffering, and I want to be able to say there is life, resurrection life to be had right in the middle of it. Right in the middle of it, God is forming something in us. Right now, whether you've been a Christian for 50 years or you became a Christian the other day at our Christmas Eve service, here's the deal. God is shaping something in you this year. God is forming and working, and the Spirit is moving in your life, and you are invited to experience that. It's not just a Christmas Eve thing. It's not just an Easter Sunday thing. Don't wait 3 more months to connect with God. You're invited to experience the work of the Spirit in your life right now. Right now, today, right where you're sitting on your couch, right where you're sitting on your bed, right where you feel lonely and overwhelmed and in the middle of suffering right now, that's where the Spirit wants to work. I love Eugene Peterson's translation of this verse. In the Message, he writes this in this passage of James. He says, don't try to get out of anything prematurely. Let it do its work in you so that you become a mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way. Don't try to get out of anything prematurely. Don't try to just dodge it. Don't try to distract yourself. Don't just wait for COVID-19 to be over to follow Jesus and experience his love for you. We will bear the shame and the trauma of COVID-19 for years and years and years and years, and we will be angry, bitter people at all that we've lost. Or by the work of the Spirit in our lives, we will rejoice and be glad. We will count it joy as we see what God has formed in us in a year like 2020. We're coming up to New Year's Eve, New Year's Day, which is always such a cool thing. And I love goal setting. I always sit down and write goals. And I made the mistake of looking at my 2020 goals from last year. Things like read this many books and run a marathon and all these things that just, there's no way they were happening in 2020. But I heard another pastor talk about this question that maybe instead of goal setting, what if we asked ourselves this year, not what goals do I need to accomplish? What do I need to do better? Because it's easy to look at that, right? I think it's a great thing to rejoice and be excited and get stoked about the idea of traveling again or going out to eat with friends or any of those things. But step back from that for just a second. Before we set goals, before we make our plans, before we try to figure out how to make our lives better, how to make 2021 better than 2020, to step back and ask ourselves the question, what is God trying to form in me? And maybe that's how you can close out the year of 2020. As you look back on the roller coaster that this year has been, and I know it has been hard, ask yourself, what is God trying to form in me? I've been processing that question a little bit, and I have a few more days here to consider it before January 1. And even though it's an arbitrary day, I want to walk into 2021 with an idea of what are the things that God's tried to form in me this year. Maybe it's, for me, it's my identity. Should not be swayed by what people say or think about me. It's learning how to lament. I'm not good at being sad. If you know me, I'm a pretty happy guy by nature, but this year has been hard and I don't really know how to be sad. And I think God's trying to show me it's okay to be sad. You can be joyful, but also experience sadness. I think God's trying to form an ability to lament in me. I think God's trying to form in me an ability to trust other people, whether that's my wife or my friends. I think God is trying to form these things in me. And I don't know what your list is, but what I do know is that there is things, whether it's one or two or three or four or a billion. There's so much that God wants to form in our lives. And 2020 was the perfect breeding ground for God to work through all the suffering, all the pain. So this year, over the next couple days, I would just encourage you, pull out a paper and a pen and your Bible and pray and think and consider, what has God been trying to form in me this year? this week, we're in a beautiful, beautiful week that maybe 2020's felt like this the whole time. I don't know about you, but there's been a lot of days where I don't know what day of the week it is. But one of my favorite parts about Christmas is that spot in between Christmas and New Year's where you're like, I don't know what day it is. I'm just eating turkey leftovers. I'm just hanging out at home watching Christmas movies. I've got all the time in the world. And maybe 2020's felt like that the whole way. But this week is a beautiful chance to rest. But what I would challenge you to do is pull out a piece of paper. At some point, take 15 minutes, 30 minutes, a couple hours if that's what you need, and consider, what is God trying to form in me? That's James' invitation to us in a year of suffering, in a year of struggle, in the year 2020. What is God trying to form in us? So we hope you have a great week. Let me pray for you as we go and we celebrate this Christmas Advent season together. Dear Jesus, we love you and we invite you to form and shape us. Even in the struggle, even in the suffering, even in the pain of a year like this, we believe, Holy Spirit, that you are working, that you are doing something, and that you love us right here where we are at. God, I just pray for those right now who are watching this who feel lonely and discouraged and disheartened, that you would come close to them, Holy Spirit, that they would experience your peace, your shalom, that surpasses all understanding. Jesus, we need your presence in our lives right now, especially as we struggle through a tough year like this. But would we celebrate today, Jesus, that you are at work, not just out there, but right here, in my life, in my world, in the middle of it, not on the other side of suffering, but in the middle of it, Jesus, that you are working. Thank you for the promise of resurrection. Thank you for the promise that you will wipe away every tear from our eyes, including the ones wept over COVID-19. Thank you, Jesus, that in the middle of suffering in 2020, that you are at work. We love you, we worship you, and we give you all our praise today. In your name, amen.
Why don't we stand and let's respond together.
Reflect, I find perspective here in the best and worst days of this life. You were always on my side. You're in the pain, you're in the promise, and on the days the furnace finds my faith, you're the fourth within the flames. I don't need to talk, it would tell me that my God isn't finished yet. If he did it before, he can do it again. So I trust in what comes next. For the God I know is known for faithfulness. Oh, 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 and my hindsight says I can trust him with what's next. Oh, more ahead than what's behind me, cause through the highs and lows and in between, God, you go ahead of me. And when you call me, I will follow. And if the water flows beneath my feet, then you pull me from the deep. Talk, it would tell me this, my God isn't finished yet. If he did it before, he can do it again. So I trust him with what comes next. For the God I know is known for faithfulness. Oh, 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 and my hindsight says I can trust him with what's next. Oh, talk, give it.
we sing together.
And my God isn't finished yet. If he did it before, he can do it again. So I trust in the what comes next. Cause my hindsight says I can count on this. My God isn't finished yet. If he did it before, he can do it again. So I trust in the what comes next. For the God
sing this together.
And praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him, above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Hey, thanks so much for joining us in the middle of your Christmas celebrations, whatever they look like this year. As you go this week, as you prepare for the new year, as you prepare your hearts for whatever it is God has in store, I just want to read one more time that verse and allow it to just wash over you and give you some joy and encouragement and strength as you go. Here's what it says, just one more time. James 1, that you can thrive in the middle of suffering. Count it all joy, my brothers and my sisters, when you face trials of many kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith, even in a year like 2020, it produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Ridge Church and anyone watching, we love you. We are praying for you. We celebrate with you as you rejoice in what God has done in 2020 and what He'll do in 2021. We want to wish you a happy new year and a Merry Christmas. Have an amazing Sunday. We can't wait to connect with you in 2021.